Greetings, ladies and gentlemen. I am honored to have this opportunity to present the paper, Lie to Me, Abusing the Mobile Content Sharing Service for Fun and Profit. My name is Li Siyi. I am currently a master candidate at Beijing University of Post and Telecommunications. Online content sharing has become a commonly used feature in social platforms. When users see a content of interest, they can share their link to some online social platforms with one click. The video shows an example of sharing news to the WeChat platform. Once shared, the shared content is displayed in an easy-to-read card that includes brief information about the shared content and the source of the share. We will use WeChat as an example to briefly introduce how third-party app developers can access and use the content sharing service interface, subsequently called Share SDK. First, the developers need to upload some basic information about the app to the corresponding developer platform for review. And after the review is passed, the developer will get an app ID that uniquely corresponds to the current app. Then the developer needs to integrate the Share SDK provided by WeChat in the source code. Initialize a Share API object and register it with the obtained app ID to get access to the Share SDK. When sharing content, the developer needs to first package the content information to be shared in a certain format and into a specific object, such as the local request in the code. When the message is reading, the developer can call the sharing interface, send a request to share, and jump to WeChat. Next, let's take a closer look at how send a request in the Share SDK actually jumps to WeChat. During the registration process, Share API defines two member variables to hold the incoming context and the app ID. Ultimately, these two member variables are used in send request to build an intent, and they are placed in the message content and the message app package files of the intent respectively. This intent is then used as a parameter to the start activity function to jump to WeChat. When WeChat receives and passes this intent, it will check whether the app ID and the package name match, and also will check whether the app signature stored in the user's device is consistent with the one stored in the open platform. As we have highlighted in blue, we can find that the app ID used for verification in the server is initially derived from the app ID used to register the Share API. Similarly, we have marked the flow of the package name in green, which can be seen to originate from the context parameter used when initializing the Share API. When both checks are passed in the WeChat server, the app name of the corresponding app will be queried according to the package name, and then it will be displayed in the Share description card. The source shown in this description card is an important reference for users who see this card to determine if the content being shared is trustworthy, as content from a trusted source app is usually also trustworthy. But is the source of this display really credible? In fact, we found an attack that can modify this source display, which is the fake-share attack proposed in this paper. The basic principle of fake-share attack is to modify the app ID and package name used when sharing. Then, it will show the fake source in the Share description card. We propose two methods to implement phishing attack. The first one is to overwrite the getPackageName function in the context to return a fake package name. Then we register by using a fake app ID matching the fake package name to make the intent construction process use the fake app ID as well. A more general attack method is construct fake intent explicitly. We just need to analyze the intent passed to the target OSA via the shell SDK and pass the format of the intent, and then directly construct the intent based on these specific formats. We have created a lightweight demo app to show the phishing attack. The attacker app we developed doesn't need to be reviewed or filed on the open platform, but can directly share some content and make the source of the description card appear as QQ, which is another popular app in China. Such a source can confuse users who send the shared card into thinking the content being shared is credible, and click on the unknown link. In addition to WeChat, we also tried phishing attack on more OSAs. Specifically, we found 35 OSAs with content sharing services by keywords, read their shared SDK documentation, checked the corresponding source code, and tried phishing attack. We eventually found that there are 7 OSAs on the market that can be exploited by the phishing attack to tamper with the sharing source display, and the attack process against them is similar to that of the WeChat. We have also developed a tool called Defash to detect the apps in the markets that have carried out phishing attacks. In the coarse grained detection phase, we use static data flow analysis and SNI match detection to initially screen out suspicious apps. Then, in the fine grained attack detection phase, we further determine whether the suspicious apps has conducted a phishing attack. We perform static data flow analysis based on FlowJoy and the Suite framework. First, we find the start activity function associated with constructing the intent that jumped to WeChat by traversing the control flow graph, and then use backward data flow analysis to find the source of the corresponding package name. In this process, if the package name found is not the real package name of the app, or if it uses a function other than getPackageName to get the package name, the app is considered suspicious because this is not the normal execution flow in the WeChat Share SDK. We also note that app IDs usually have a specific format, so we can also locate the app ID directly through regular matching, and then perform forward data flow analysis to see which start activity statements this app ID might be flowing to. As forward and backwards analysis front a closed loop, we can directly through the data flow to find the corresponding app ID and the package name used to build intent. Then, if the package name is not consistent with the real package name of the app itself, it can be determined that the app is trying to implement phishing attack. We describe more details about the data flow analysis algorithm in our paper. Since the data flow analysis may fail due to the overly complex app exclusion process, we propose SNI match detection methods to improve the recall rate. In SNI match detection, we match package name and app ID content in the app one by one into a temporary sharing identification information, short as SNI, and then try to share using these SNIs. Once the sharing fails, the app is considered suspicious because it indicates that the app contains an app ID that doesn't belong to him. Finally, for the filtered suspicious app, We use the app automation test to automatically trigger the share button and capture the information of the intent in the start activity. If the package name stored in the intent doesn't match the real package name of the app, then it can be determined that a phishing attack has been implemented. Otherwise, it is just as a benign app. In the evaluation section, we first tested the performance of the fetch in lab. We first modified the benign app to phishing app to build the benchmark. Experiments were then conducted on this dataset and the results are shown in the table. The fetch can detect phishing attack with 100% accuracy in the benchmark we created. We then applied DeFetch to the real app market dataset to find out whether the adversaries have leveraged the phishing attack. And then we successfully used DeFetch to detect that 51 apps have implemented the phishing attack. We found that these 51 phishing apps all belong to money-making apps. These apps display an article list and claim that users can earn money by sharing articles to friends. But the articles that were shared contain a lot of advertising, and these ads are often some kind of fake marketing. We think that these apps want to lure other users to click by modifying the source display of the shared description card in order to gain advertising profit. We also collected the app IDs of the other apps obtained from these 51 fixture apps with the corresponding package name. This table shows the downloads of the apps corresponding to the 10 app IDs that appear most frequently in the course of these fixture apps. They are extremely high downloads, with the highest reaching 11,046,000,000 and the lowest at 14,300,000. This means that the SII of popular apps is most likely to be stolen for phishing attack. We would also like to know how feasible it is to perform a phishing attack. We designed a method similar to the SII match detection phase in DeFetch to my SII that can be used to implement phishing attack. Finally, we successfully met 24,515 usable SIIs from 73,014 apps. It shows the weakness of the SII protection in existing apps. In conclusions, we identify and demonstrate the feasibility of phishing attack, a novel type of attack to tamper with the shared source display in the shared content description card. We also devise and implement DeFetch, a multi-granularity detection tool that can identify phishing attack. Furthermore, we collected more than 24,000 SIIs that can be leveraged to implement phishing attack. So, OSA needs to re-examine the security of the released shell SDK, and the benign app developers should store and use their own SII in a secure manner.
Take one CE. There we are. Okay. I have a question, but I will get will give precedence to anyone else. Would you please activate the video?
Okay. Okay. I think.
Is it anyway possible? And are there any questions around? I will start. How easy is it to track to trick DeFetch?
It It's developed by the Flowdroid and the Suit, and we package it into a jar package, and I think it is easy to use it.
But yes, I understand. But how hard it is to it is it to trick it?
Trick it. Trick it.
To pretend that I'm an app that does correct sharing when I'm in reality running a fake share attack.
Yes. In fact, we have found that there are some malicious apps use information such as app ID obtained from the server. It can trick the static data flow analysis, but maybe in the fine grain detection phase, just the dynamic SII capture phase. We can capture this, but it may be use more time, and in our evaluation, it's on average it use over 10 minutes to detect this kind of apps. Yes.
Okay. Thanks, Punch. Any other questions?
I have a quick question. So, Siyi, it's an interesting talk. So, I wonder, so the experiment that you have conducted are mainly on the Android platform. Have you considered the iOS platform? And did you see any difference when you are doing in that platform as well?
Good questions. We only focus on the Android and maybe not attention to the iOS systems. Yes.